And thank you, Chairperson, for introducing the topic. Before I start, it made my job easy. And I would like to thank Dr. Praveen, my batchmate. We did MD from PGH India. And we are close friends and also associated with Diaplus Group. And he is the main person who is instrumental behind this society, basically. So when he asked me which topic to discuss, I wanted to talk on topic which people don't talk on. So that I will read and I will also help others in enlightening topic. And this was one such topic which I wanted to do. So by force, I got this topic given. So I will be talking on sleep disorders and psychiatric illness. And one way, this topic is unique. Because as and when I speak, you can see some live demonstration happening around you. So in between, just look around. So you can understand it better. So with this. So having said that, the agenda is mind-blowing. Because there are so many things. So many things which I was about to see. But I restrict myself to a few of these things which I mentioned here. So what I'll be doing is, I'll be talking on sleep and various sleep disorders, prevalence of sleep disorders, obstructive sleep apnea and diabetes, psychiatry and diabetes, substance abuse and diabetes. Again, it comes under the purview of psychiatry, depression and psychosis in diabetes, and psychiatry, medications and diabetes, the interaction. So sleep disorders are not new. It has been there for since ages. Can you pick up this character from the Kumbhagami? Yeah. He sleeps for 6 months and he is awake for 6 months. He has got all the features of metabolic syndrome, obstructive sleep apnea and other things. So this has been there for ages. This is not a new invention or of the modern times. So what is sleep? Sleep is basically a biological function and is essential for life. Basically, there is a U-shape association between body mass index and sleep duration. Defects in sleep quality and quantity can result in metabolic errors and cardiovascular dysfunction, the other side of it. Diabetes invites emotional reaction, which can also affect sleep adversely. So there is a bidirectional association between sleep and diabetes. So what is normal sleep? Basically, there are five phases of sleep. Phase 1, 2, 3 and 4, and the final one is the REM, or the rapid eye movement sleep, in which we experience dreams. We spend around 50% of our sleep during the phase 2 and 20% of the sleep during REM sleep and 30% in other stages. Experts say if you feel drowsy during the day, you haven't slept enough. So most valid indicator. Most adults need 7 to 8 hours of sleep, but most of them don't sleep this much duration. And teenagers need around 9 hours and infants require around 16 hours a day. So there are few things which should be cautiously used, like clozapine, olanzapine, risperidone, butenapine, and aripiprazole has to be preferred over other drugs in this scenario. And is there a way out? Yes, there is a way out. It has been shown in individual studies and meta-analysis and systemic review. If you use metformin in such patient, the weight gain due to the medication is half. If he has to gain 6 kgs, he will gain only 3 kgs if you give full dose of metformin. So there is one way out. In such patient, use full dose of metformin. Thereby the weight gain which happens with these drugs can be minimized. So all these patients, at every visit, you have to check their weight, at every under blood pressure, and every 3 months you do a lipid profile, and every 6 months and 1 year there are guidance to say you have to do a GTT if they are gaining weight. And always talk with your psychiatrist and ask them if there is any way out. Can we choose this metabolically neutral or less complicating antipsychotics compared to the one he is receiving? So if you do a crosstalk between these two departments, the complications can be minimized. And what is this impact of psychiatric illness in diabetes? There is a stigma in seeking help for comorbid psychiatric disorders. It impairs the treatment adherence. These people are more likely to receive poor diabetes care and it impairs the self-management which they are supposed to do. And not the more, sexual dysfunction also comes under psychiatric disorders. It is said that men with diabetes suffer erectile dysfunction at an early age and they suffer more severe erectile dysfunction. They have got worst disease-specific quality of life and they are less responsive to the usual care of treatment. And men with ED show distress, depressive symptom, marked effect on interpersonal relationship, and antipsychotic use in such patients adds fuel to the fire. It increases the bloating, more decreases libido. So the cycle continues. And similarly, females also have got increased sexual dysfunction. Around 27 to 42% of the females I mean have sexual dysfunction with diabetes in the form of decreased sexual desire, dyspareunia, vaginismus, orgasmic disorder and sexual arousal disorder. So I think I put everything in a nutshell, still everything, there are so many things which can be covered. So to conclude, interaction of diabetes and psychiatric disorder is multifaceted. Diabetologists and psychiatrists need to work together. Early screening and timely referral are mandatory. Psychosocial approach and shared decision making in diabetes management are the need of the hour.